So just a brief introduction to the habitat, and stop me at any time. I think we'll talk just for maybe less than a half hour, and then I hope to have a broader discussion. But this is Todd Marcy's diagram that shows the Great Lakes habitats, and I've added to it some indicators of depth here in feet for those of you who think in terms of feet. 15 feet, this much of the lakes, or 30 feet, this much. 15 feet is about the thickness of this room. So we're talking about the thinnest film over the top of the Great Lakes that have temperatures as warm as 68 to sometimes 75 degrees. And this is maybe two floors. Think of that as the amount of warm water habitat, except that the warm water habitat is also restricted over to the shoreward a couple of miles where the waters are shallow enough. That's partly why it gets warm. And that's where much of the food is, and that's where most of the fish hang out. So we will say a few things about the warm water fishery of the Great Lakes. Notice there's very little fish life out here, supposedly representing toward the open water. And then look at what happens. These are bathymetric data that I was lucky enough to spend a summer doing this kind of work on the Great Lakes when I was a graduate student, when I started out here. But look how cold it gets very quickly. And so down to 57 degrees or 55, which is 12°C, below that is the cold water of the Great Lakes, this huge mass of water that goes down an average of 280 feet to a maximum depth in Lake Michigan of 925 feet. In Lake Superior, the maximum depth is 1,330 feet, which I had the pleasure of visiting 13 times in a little research submarine, and it's quite a thrill, except as you might guess, you can only see down there with big lights because below the very top, the whole rest of the Great Lakes is not only cold, but black and lightless. But unlike the tropical lakes, it's oxygenated to the bottom and has a fish and invertebrate fauna that goes clear to the bottom, unlike many of the warm water lakes on the planet. The warm water fish mostly inhabit the bays and estuaries and shallow parts like Western Lake Erie, Green Bay, Saginaw Bay. And this has the rich fish fauna. Most of our fish will inhabit this area, and Asian carp, if and when they get here, will inhabit this particular kind of habitat. But you see here, numerically, the dominant Great Lakes fishes. And the ones that you're most interested in if you're a fisherman, but if you're an angler, sport fisher, or recreational fisher, this is the area where you want to be because this is where the bass and pike and muskies and many of the salmonids move into this area from some of the colder water. So one of the things we do in the book is divide these habitats up and show which fish live where. This is the food chain, Todd's diagram of the food chain, which is better represented here because if you look closely, and you can see it here but not here, but you have to get up close, you see that the food chain has two directions of energy flow. These are the predators, and each of these levels eats fish in the level below, and these are the forage fish, minnows and suckers, things like that, where up here we have gars, burbot, and the big salmonids that make up the main food web. And so we'll focus on those fish just a little bit as we go along for discussion, because those are the ones that anglers are most interested in. If any of you are commercial fishers, then you know that the interesting ones are the whitefish, salmonids, and so on, that live in the deep water. And so we'll get to those. The main deep water fish of interest to me is the deep water sculpin. And I had used the device of introducing you to the blue water, but of course most of these live in water that's black without light. But these are what we were studying in the submarine. You'd be absolutely astonished to see these little 4 or 5 inch fish, one every 4 or so square meters on the bottom, clear across the whole Lake Superior. They're less common in Lake Michigan, Lake Huron, because their environment has been wrecked. They are extinct in Lake Ontario because the fish and their habitat was totally wrecked there a long time ago. So, but this is the fish that's at the base of the fish part of the base of the food chain. Great Lakes Coregonids form the planktivores in the system, those that are left. They were in part eliminated in the 60s when the introduced alewife came into the system and increased in abundance to become 90 or more percent of the whole biomass of Lake Michigan, for example, and the other lower Great Lakes outside of Superior. So these became the terrible problem because they had eliminated the Siskos or Lake Herring from all but Lake Superior, actually bringing about with overfishing by commercial fishermen the extinction of 3 species of Siskos and the elimination of over 20 different populations of these fish in the lakes. Surprisingly, this is the jewel of the Great Lakes fish system. The lake whitefish, which I hope all of you have had a chance to enjoy in restaurants, is the only remaining really sustainable commercial fish in the Great Lakes. And it has remained sustainable by some really remarkable biological changes that it has managed to do in order to remain in its viable position. They were almost wiped out by the zebra mussels, so that fishermen up around Traverse City were throwing them back rather than filleting them to sell to restaurants and to markets, because they were so thin that they didn't have enough to fillet. Then a really remarkable biological thing occurred in that quagga mussels, which grow faster than zebra mussels and have thin shells, overgrew the zebra mussels, and the Great Lakes whitefish quickly learned to eat them. And so now those populations are in good shape again, and you can get good, thick whitefish fillets in restaurants again. So that's the star of Great Lakes fishes right here.